Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Steve Case, Chairman and CEO of Revolution, and Kimberly Weisel, Inc. Magazine Editor at Large.
Hello.
Hello.
It is my pleasure to be here with Steve Case, who probably knows more about the startup ecosystems nationwide than anyone else, and cares about fostering innovation across the country, not just in sort of venture-backed hotspots. So thank you very much for joining
us. Glad to be here.
And maybe you can show us a little bit about what you've been up to.
I think we have a short video we can kick it off with.
Yeah.
Play the video. Yeah.
We're really bothered by the fact that an overwhelming amount of venture capital and attention goes to a relatively small number of entrepreneurs in a relatively small number of places. We want to make sure every entrepreneur everywhere in the country, if they have an idea, they really have a shot of turning that into a startup and really a shot at the American dream. Last year in this country, 75% of venture capital went to three states, California, New York, Massachusetts, 75%. The other 47 states fought over the remaining 25%. This challenge around leveling the playing field is not just around place, so that's super important, it's also around people. Last year in this country, over 90% of venture capital went to men, less than 10% to women. Less than 1% of venture capital went to African Americans. And that's obviously not right, but it's also not smart. We need to make sure we're backing everybody everywhere, and that's what motivates us to hit the road. We believe the rest will rise. We really do. We have no idea which cities will rise the fastest. And the reason we don't know is it has nothing to do with what we do and everything to do with what you do.
Excellent. So,
thank you.
In that video, you mentioned that 75% of venture capital goes to three states. I got an email from your team updating me earlier this week, 79% right now. Why is this, and why is it not changing?
Well, it's starting to, people are a little more open to it than before, but the venture capital is really a half century idea. It's not been around that long. It started mostly in San Francisco, mostly in New York, because the capital was there and there are great universities like Stanford and others in Silicon Valley. It really became the epicenter of innovation for the last several decades. But what I've been talking about for a while is this next wave of innovation, what I've thought of as the third wave of the internet. Partnerships with other companies are going to be more important. Public policy, regulatory issues are going to become more important. And domain expertise is going to become more important. Knowing something about farming, knowing something about healthcare, not just knowing about the coding, but more the culture of those industries is going to become more important. I think that will advantage these rise of the rest cities. But we have to back the entrepreneurs, or otherwise they'll leave. And there has been a huge brain drain in many parts of the country. People growing up there or going to school there did leave because they felt the opportunity was better on the coast. We have to slow that brain drain and create a boomerang of people returning by backing the entrepreneurs there, helping them start and scale the next great companies.
So your funds are directly addressing the access to capital part of this. What are the other elements of the startup ecosystem that are lacking in some of these cities?
We published a report, Rise the Rest, you can look at it on our website, kind of a playbook in terms of ecosystems, and there's seven or eight things that are worth focusing on, but given limited time, I'll just focus on three. One is the capital. The money issue is super important. The other, I referenced it briefly, is talent. How do you kind of make sure you keep the people you already have, and how do you become a magnet for other people? Because you do need that talent to scale these companies. But the third is a subtler point, really around culture, is how do you create more of a fearless culture in your community, more of an anything is possible culture. That is one of the great things about Silicon Valley. They hear an idea and they say, wow, that can change the world. I wonder how big it can be. Most people in many parts of the country, when they hear an idea, they focus on what might go wrong as opposed to what might go right. And just recognizing, having the big companies in your city recognize the future of these communities are going to be in the hands of the startups. Half of the Fortune 500 turns over every 25 years. So if you're not investing in new companies, some of which will fail, but some of which will succeed, you're not going to like the way your community looks 25 years from now.
So what have cities done to address these three things that has worked? What are the trends you see and what's helping cities grow their startup ecosystems?
A key ingredient is driving more collaboration. So getting the university, trying to focus more on entrepreneurship on campus and connect it to other things in the community. Get some of the large companies, Fortune 500 companies, to recognize that it's in their self-interest to understand what's happening with startups, kind of in the periphery, because that might impact their business down the road. But it's also critically important in terms of the culture they create. So, for example, in Cincinnati, some of the big companies, Procter & Gamble and others, got together and created an accelerator, a physical space, and also created a fund of funds to invest in venture capital. That was an example of the big companies coming together and saying things are important. In Detroit, I was in Detroit last week, and a lot of things are now happening in Detroit. But for those who don't know the full story, 100 years ago, Detroit essentially was Silicon Valley. It was the most innovative city in the country, probably in the world, when the car was sort of the hot technology of the day. But then over the last half century, kind of got complacent and lost 60% of its population and then went bankrupt. In the last 5-6 years, it's really fought its way back. We've, through our Rise Arrest Fund, have invested in half a dozen companies in Detroit and also some in Ann Arbor and in Traverse City. And it's an example of the community coming together, led by an entrepreneur, Dan Gilbert, a strong mayor, strong governor, foundations like Kresge, large companies, including some of the auto companies, saying we really need to create a more startup culture in our community. And now Detroit, which for decades has been on the decline, is now on the rise again. So it requires people to pay attention. One thing that happened last year, I'm sure many people are aware of, is Amazon was in search of its second headquarters.
Oh yeah.
And 235 cities, I think it was, applied to try to win the Amazon headquarters. And ultimately they ended up deciding on Northern Virginia area. If those same people took half of the energy they put into making that bid, they're community-wide, how do you drive more collaboration, exactly some of the things I'm talking about. If half of that energy and half of the money they put on the table to lure Amazon and refocus that on creating a stronger startup community, they might create the next Amazon. And getting economic development to focus less on trying to lure the businesses of the past and more on creating the businesses, indeed the industries of the future, is what we need more of, particularly on the policy side.
I want to ask you a bit more about the collaboration sort of hurdle, because I was lucky enough to be on one of the Rise of the Rest bus tours for a short period of time. And one of the things that I noticed was that some of the institutions that we visited were all about their city, really civic boosters. And a couple of them who looked as if they could be key players were kind of all about, well, you should come here because we're here, right? And they were much more about their reputation. So how do you turn those institutions around? Is it possible to go forward without them if they are major and anchor institutions in a city?
We need to get everybody working together collaboratively. And it's obviously easy to say, harder to do. And there's an African proverb I'm sure most people here are familiar with. If you want to go quickly, you can go alone. But if you want to go far, you must go together. That's sort of the mindset that we bring to this work around promoting kind of regional entrepreneurship, trying to help strengthen these rising cities. It can't be done just with one person, one organization, one mayor, one anything. It really requires kind of collaboration and people saying, we need to bet on the future. And the surprise to me, I first got into this work almost a decade ago when I was asked to co-chair something part of the White House called the National Advisory Council on Innovation and Entrepreneurship, which led to an initiative we launched at the White House that President Obama asked me to chair called Startup America. I did not know until that point in time that the business world really had three separate sectors, and that if you looked at what was happening with small businesses, large businesses, and young kind of new businesses, essentially all the job creation was the new business.
Right.
Small businesses accounts for a lot of jobs, but not a lot of job growth. A restaurant on Main Street goes out of business, somebody else will probably move in. It'll probably be a restaurant. They'll probably hire about the same number of people. Fortune 500, there are companies like Amazon that are growing, but there are also companies like GE that are declining. As a sector, it's not creating jobs. So the job growth is this new company. So if you're not focusing on these startups that are in that new company formation growth mode, you're not going to be creating jobs in your community. Even if you look at the data, we talked about 75% of venture capital going to three states. Part of the political discussion we're having in this country is around how many people in the country are optimistic about the future versus anxious about the future. And the two data points I'd cite, Pew, a research organization, did a study last year and said 75% of Americans are anxious about the future. If you look at the states that President Trump won, which is about 30 states, and you add up all the venture capital in all of those states, it was 15%.
Wow.
1-5. And so given the role startup play in job creation and the role venture capital plays in driving the fastest growing, biggest job creating companies, the fact that over 50% of venture capital is in California and less than 1% is in Pennsylvania, less than 1% is in Ohio, and less than 1% is in Michigan, we shouldn't be surprised a lot of people in the country are feeling this technology disruption, innovation thing is happening in a few places and benefiting a few people. It's not really helping them, they're not really helping their family, not really helping their community. So it's an investment strategy for us, an arbitrage. We think we'll actually make more money as investors backing these entrepreneurs because valuations are lower than those same companies were in places like Silicon Valley. But we also think it's critically important to level the playing field so everybody everywhere really does feel like they have a shot at the American dream. And the next time Pew does a research study, hopefully more people feel like there's a reason to stay where they are, there's a reason to believe in their community. Yeah.
So your fund so far has been very successful. And one of the things that you've said, it's because you're not relying on these few breakout companies to make up for the ones that fail. How does that affect how you pick companies? Are you consciously looking for slower growing companies with smaller total addressable market?
No,
like
we
sounds
are not.
Unlikely.
We are not.
So what are these companies doing differently and how do you find it?
Well, first I should say, Revolution, the investment firm I started and run, we really have three different groups. One is Rise of the Rest, focused on early stage seed investing. Then we have Revolution Ventures as a company starts scaling and Revolution Growth when they're really in a growth phase. And each of them operates a little differently and the way they approach investing is a little bit different. On the Rise of Rest side, we're really partnering with regional venture funds. We've made over 100 investments in 70 cities and 30 states over the last 3 years. On the Revolution Ventures and Revolution Growth side, we're much more focused. We make 4 or 5 investments a year on the venture side, 4 or 5 investments a year on the growth side. And obviously, when we're looking at growth companies, we're really looking for that expansion. I was indeed pleased to see in Inc. magazine this week that one of the companies we backed, Tala, with a female founder, Shivani, was on the list of the
company.
Inc. female 100 kind of entrepreneurs list, and that's an example of a company that's really in growth mode. But the key on the Rise Rest side is to recognize that while Silicon Valley is great and will continue to be great, a lot of great things are happening here in New York City or Boston or other places, there are also great things happening all over the country. And understanding what's happening in these communities, understanding what the opportunities are in terms of what industries they can lead on, and really nurturing stronger, more thriving startup communities, and spending a lot of time trying to identify the entrepreneurs that could be the big successes of tomorrow. We hope more venture capitalists on the coast spend more time in the middle of the country. We know they'll find great opportunities. We also think that's the way to unify a country that is becoming more and more split apart.
Your funds also, and I've been told this is not an explicit mandate, have a much larger proportion of women and people of color that you've backed. Why do you think that is? Because you're going to parts of the country where people mistakenly, I think that there's not a lot of diversity.
Well, there's much more diversity in terms of the entrepreneurial communities in most parts of the middle of the country than there are on the coast, which is sort of counterintuitive. And to your point, we've now backed, I think it's 30 female founders through the different investments we've made. And the last Rise of the Rest tour, you saw in the video kind of how we do these bus tours in different places. The last tour we did, 4 of the 5 winners were female founders.
Yeah, and I mean, nationwide, we're talking like the most generous estimate would tell you 10% goes to women and one to people of color.
Right.
So no, it's the most generous estimate.
And the reason the proportion is higher for what we're doing is we're more intentional about it. When we're coming to town, we have a team that starts working months in advance, and who, you know, what are the key groups in terms of venture capitalists and accelerators, incubators, universities, what have you. And we try to make sure when we're coming to town that people know we're coming, and we're inviting a lot of people from a lot of parts of the community to apply to pitch. But for most cities we visit, 100 companies, 100 startups apply to pitch. We pick the 8 we think are most interesting, and then we pick and invest in the one that we think is the best of the bunch. So when you have more people on stage, when you really give them an opportunity, they shine. And I think you'll see more and more of that over the next 10, 15 years. I do think we'll be able to level the playing field in terms of place. I do think we'll be able to level the playing field in terms of people. And as I said in the video, really create this dynamic where everybody, everywhere, really does feel like they have a shot at the American dream. But we have a lot of work to do. We're making a little bit of progress, but as you said, the data hasn't really moved. I'm okay with that because 40 years ago, 35 years ago, when we started AOL, 34 years ago exactly, only 3% of people were online.
Amazing.
And they're only online 1 hour a week. And most people didn't think the internet was a good idea.
You're
most
used to people, thinking long-term.
I've got a conference like this and talk about the internet. I said, you really think people are going to sit at a keyboard and type a message to somebody? Pick up the phone and call? That's stupid, and you are not going to be successful. It took us a decade before people finally paid attention, and then another decade to get, you know, America online and the world online. So when we talk about Rise of Rest, we know some people are skeptical, and can you really build great companies in Detroit or Indianapolis or Denver or places like that? We know you can because it's happening. We just are going to do whatever we can to kind of showcase that, shine a spotlight dot, and back this next generation of entrepreneurs and try to bring some of the capital on the coast to opportunities in the middle of the country.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much. It's important work that you're doing, and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you all. Great to see you.
Yeah, I got it.